Good morning. Welcome, parents, grandparents, board of trustees, faculty, and graduating class of 2017 to our commencement celebration. Graduates, this has been a journey for you. You are prepared to transition. We are excited to celebrate in this event with you and with your family. If you haven't already, take time, graduates, to thank your parents, thank your grandparents, thank the adults who have walked along with you on this journey. Your journey is not complete today. Many of you will transition, all of you will transition to higher ed. You will begin to start formulating your allegiance in higher ed, and that's normal. Your parents, your grandparents, they all probably have strong affiliations to their college alma mater, and all of you are going to an institution where you will spend a significant amount of time there, and you will grow fond of that institution, and rightfully so. I would say, don't forget about your elementary teachers. Don't forget about your middle school teachers. Don't forget about your high school teachers. You see, you might have great memories watching the football games and basketball games and athletic events at higher ed. You may enjoy your fraternities, your sororities, and your clubs, and that's all normal. And I suspect your place of higher ed will be very diligent to put you on their email list and text list so that you can give money to your college alma mater. Again, that is normal. You will be a booster and a supporter. But I would say, don't forget about the teacher who taught you how to read, who taught you how to socialize. Don't forget about the people who loved you to get you to that point. And most of all, your parents who nurtured you and your grandparents who walked alongside you. So this day is, while it's certainly a celebration for you and your accomplishments, your academic endeavors, this is also a celebration for your parents, your grandparents, and those who love you. As you think about this idea of allegiance, I want to leave you with this thought as we begin. In the New Testament, the term for faith is pistis. And we see that all through the pages of Scripture, we are saved by faith through grace. There's another connotation of that same idea, and that is one of allegiance. Some have suggested that maybe what we are called to do as Christ followers is to give him our allegiance. He is King Jesus, King of our lives. And so as you transition and you think about the ways in which you allocate your time, your commitment, and your allegiance, make sure and keep Jesus the center of all that you do. May your allegiance be to him as he will continue to bless you and guide you. That's the DNA of Dallas Christian School. We spend a lot of time talking about academic aspects. Today is very much an academic celebration. The regalia represents academic accomplishments, your GPAs, your scholarships, your studies. You'll be launching into doing research, entering into a higher ed of academic arena. Do not confuse your allegiance to your academic studies with your allegiance to the Almighty Maker who formed you in his image, who died for you and reconciled you to himself, to be in a lifelong relationship with you for eternity. Our allegiance is there. May this endeavor and your future endeavors simply be a way in which you can celebrate God's goodness and mercy in your life. This is a very gifted class and talented class. When I look out at this graduating class, there is no doubt in my mind, you will do great things in life. You will do great things and accomplish great things. Use your giftedness, your talents, your humility to serve Jesus. Radiate his love to those that are around you. We're excited to walk this path with you and celebrate today. Right now, we'll be led in the Pledge of Allegiance by our senior ASL students. Thank you.
And to I will be reading three short passages, the first from Deuteronomy chapter 6. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts, impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. Well, over 1,000 years later, this question was asked from Mark chapter 12. One of the teachers of the law asked Jesus, "Of all the commandments, which is the most important?" Jesus answered, "The most important one is this, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your mind and with all your strength. The second is this, love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these." And lastly, from John chapter 10, "Therefore Jesus said again, I tell you the truth, I am the gate for the sheep. All who ever came before me were thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. He will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full." Will you bow with me in prayer? Dear Father, so many emotions today. Nostalgia, pride, joy, relief, hope, anticipation. There's so much that we want to tell our graduates, so much that we hope we have passed on to them, so much we would like to protect them from, so much wisdom we want to give them. But you are the Father of wisdom and our sole protection, and so we put them in your hands, Lord. We give them to you. We pray beyond all else, we have taught them to love you with all their heart and soul and strength, and to love their neighbor, Lord. We pray that with all the loud voices of the world, they listen to your Son's voice. We pray they appreciate your Son, wants them to have life and have it to the full, and someday to have eternal life with him. We ask that you bless them, Lord, with joy, patience, and most of all, wisdom. We pray that they will use these blessings to serve others, to serve their friends, their family, and to serve those that are less fortunate. Lord, we thank you for Dallas Christian. We thank you for the 60 years this school has been dedicated to teaching kids to know you, love you, to know your Son, to love your Son, and his sacrifice for us. It's in his holy name that we pray. Amen.
Per strada time to Good morning. I now have the pleasure to introduce Dallas Christian Salutatorian for the class of 2017, Miss Corey McDougall. This year marked Corey's 11th year at Dallas Christian. Corey and her family attend the First Assembly of God in Kauffman, where she teaches the 3 to 5 year olds, volunteers with VBS, and completed the church's girls ministry program. Corey is a 3-year member of the National Honor Society. She supported our athletic teams as a cheerleader during her high school years, and she could also be seen on stage or working behind the scenes in the drama department's one-act play and musical productions, including Annie, You Can't Take It With You, Into the Woods, Sense and Sensibility, and most recently in Fiddler on the Roof. Corey has been a member of the Bible Leadership Group for 2 years, a group that is responsible for planning and executing most of our chapel activities. Corey consistently represented DC in academic competitions all 4 years in high school. One of Corey's greatest accomplishments at Dallas Christian is in the field of debate. During her freshman year, with the aid of her debate coach at the time, Mrs. Emily Taylor, Corey had significant success in Lincoln-Douglas debate competitions. This was amazing to me and to Ms. Courtney and Mrs. Taylor, as we knew how difficult debate can be, especially for someone with no experience. With that early success under her belt, Corey basically took over the debate program, recruiting and coaching other students. It was simply impressive. Dedicated, thorough, driven. These are words that describe any student who has achieved high academic standing, but they are especially applicable to Corey. I've enjoyed having her in my English class this year. She and I are like-minded in that we are strong advocates for the Oxford comma. I feel good knowing that she will carry the torch forward and fight for the Oxford comma's universal usage. Stay strong, sister. Corey will attend Texas A&M University in College Station, where she intends to study forensics and investigative sciences with an emphasis in science. Corey would one day like to work for the FBI. It would not surprise me one bit to hear that she is indeed doing that. It is my pleasure to introduce the salutatorian for the class of 2017, Corey McDougall.
Now I'm ready. Friday, people started asking me what I was going to speak on today, and I had to tell everyone the same thing. I have no idea. I knew I didn't want to give advice about moving on and moving into the real world, because if anyone is truly a wreck over school ending, it's me. So I just kept putting it off. And just like he did with before every last minute chapel talk, God came through with a topic that's relevant and has been at the forefront of our year since last spring. A few weeks ago, I started a devotional on the Bible app called Fearless, because honestly, leaving these people sitting in front of me and behind me terrifies me. But no one I talked to liked the idea of everyone staying. I proposed the idea of everyone going together, but I didn't get any takers on that offer either. So since my classmates were dead set on graduating and pursuing their dreams, I knew I needed to get over this fear of leaving DC. I also knew I was not going to be able to get over it on my own. But I knew that people face much more frightening things in the Bible, so I knew I could find a lot of encouragement. All that to say, Saturday night, I was reading my devotional, and the scripture reading to go along with it was Joshua chapter 1. We all know our theme verse, Joshua 1:9. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. But these verses before it are invaluable in providing the context. After the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord said to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' aide, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now then, you and all these people, get ready to cross the Jordan River into the land I'm about to give them. To the Israelites, I will give you every place where you set your foot, as I promised Moses. Your territory will extend from the desert to Lebanon and from the great river, the Euphrates, all the Hittite country, to the Mediterranean Sea in the west. No one will be able to stand against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Be strong and courageous, because you will lead these people to inherit the land I swore to the ancestors to give them. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it, from the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. Keep this book of the law always on your lips. Meditate on it day or night, so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Joshua 1:1-8. I've been in church my entire life, so I've heard plenty of talks about not letting fear and worry control your life. And Joshua 1:9 makes it crystal clear. It's not a suggestion, it's a command. Be strong and courageous. So I've always felt like I was doing something wrong because I just wasn't waking up every morning with this incredible courage. But I realized reading this passage that God doesn't expect us to figure out how to become courageous on our own. He gives us instructions. God didn't send Joshua out expecting him to have it all together just because Moses had died. In the same way, he doesn't expect us to have everything together just because we're graduating high school. We've got at least 3 years to cross our Jordans and to fully accept our leadership roles. Now back to those things God gives us to build courage, because I know y'all didn't think you were getting out of here without me giving you a checklist. Be ready. Obey God's word. Meditate on God's word. It's that simple, because our courage isn't based on our own strength. God promises to not only be with us, but he also says he will keep all of his promises, and he won't let anyone stand against us, because he's got a plan. Now, I know y'all in this first section have some idea of where you want to go with your life, and that's good. Or maybe you have absolutely no idea what you want to do, and that's good too. Because God, who can see our entire lives at once, past, present, and future, has a perfect plan for our lives. All we have to do is courageously follow it. Thank you.
I now have the honor to introduce Dallas Christian's valedictorian for the class of 2017, Miss Anna Wilson. This year marked Anna's eighth year at Dallas Christian, and during her time here, she has made significant impact on our school. Anna is a 3-year member of National Honor Society. She competed on the cross-country team for 2 years and also represented DC on the academic team. I can speak firsthand about her talent and skills as a writer and critical thinker. She has a natural voice and flow in her writing. It's just a pleasure to read. Some of our students benefited from her skills as she has served as an English tutor. Anna has been a member of the Bible Leadership Group for 2 years. She was out in the forefront during a number of our chapel times delivering devotionals that challenged the teachers and staff as well as the students. Anna has logged some truly meaningful volunteer experiences. She went on the mission trip to Hinatega, Nicaragua, has worked at Kids Beach Club, a Christian-based after-school program at Kimball Elementary in Mesquite, and has volunteered at Sharing Life, a charitable nonprofit organization whose purpose is to come alongside families in Mesquite in Southeast Dallas and give them basic life necessities. You watch Anna and you may think she's shy or she doesn't have much to say. I would advise you not to confuse her quietness with weakness. After all, you don't get to the top without a competitive spirit. Most may not know this, but Anna is a pretty good ping pong player and still does 4 mile runs 3 or 4 times per week. Anna has an adventurous spirit. She loves the outdoors, swimming, and hiking. She already has a bucket list, which includes things like traveling to all 7 continents, skydiving, seeing the Northern Lights, and competing on the amazing race with fellow graduate Erica Sotelo. I would love to watch Anna and Erica quietly go about their business and kick every other team's tail. Anna will attend Wheatland College in Illinois, where she intends to major in biology and pre-med with a long-term vision of going into medical missions. It is my pleasure to introduce the valedictorian for the class of 2017, Anna Wilson.
Wow, I can't believe this day is finally here. We are finally graduating and starting the next stage of our lives. For some, this day is bittersweet as it marks the end of high school. For others, this day couldn't have gotten here faster as it too marks the end of high school. I know for me, I fall in the latter group. As fun and memorable as these last 4 years have been, I've always been excited and ready for college. And when I say always, I mean always. I remember back when I was about 6 years old or so, I woke up one day and thought, I need to start preparing for college. And I know y'all are probably thinking, what six-year-old thinks that? And I don't know, but I came to the conclusion that in order to start preparing for college, I would need to work on being more independent. So that morning, I climbed up onto the counter, grabbed a bowl, and poured my own cereal. As I sat there eating my Cap'n Crunch, I couldn't help but feel pleased with the progress I made towards becoming a mature, independent college kid. Whether you start preparing for college at age 6 or just plan on winging it, I'm confident that these next few years are going to be profound and unforgettable. But amidst this time of celebration and looking ahead at what lies before us, I know that there's some apprehension, some fear what our futures are going to look and be like. Some of us respond to this fear by overplanning for anything and everything that could come our way. We create an elaborate map of what we want our futures to look like so that it's as predictable and safe as possible. Others respond to that fear by just closing their eyes, jumping, and hoping everything will turn out okay. But both of these extremes cause more harm than good, and I believe there's a better way to go about handling our fears. One of my favorite songs by the band Need to Breathe is called Keep Your Eyes Open. And I think some of the lyrics offer sage advice for the worries and nerves we have going forward towards our future. Throughout the song, the lead singer, Bear Reinhardt, says to keep your eyes open. I've thought about what he means when he says that, as it isn't something you hear people say too often. And I think it means a couple things. When a child sees something scary, their natural response is to close their eyes. In the same way, when something that evokes fear is looming before us, we want to close our eyes to the situation or thing that is causing our discomfort. We want to get away from it. But if we close our eyes to the things causing us fear in order to avoid them, we'll miss out on so much more in life. We'll miss out on opportunities, relationships, and most importantly, the growth that results from facing our fears and overcoming them.
To keep your eyes open also means that when the map of our future that we spent so much time drawing up begins to fall apart, we must not lose heart. When the major you planned on isn't going well and you have to rethink your future career, or when a relationship that you invested so much into suddenly ends, or when homesickness hits you hard, you must keep your eyes open in order to see the new path God wants to lead you down. When we fail or things don't go the way we planned, we can't just give in to despair. Instead, we need to keep our eyes open to see the new opportunities and relationships ahead of us. Bear Reinhardt also says in the song, "If you never leave home, never let go, you'll never make it to the great unknown." If we allow fear and uncertainty of the future to keep us at our literal or metaphorical homes, if we never let go what is safe and certain in our world in order to reach out for what is new and better, we will never reach the beautiful, fulfilling places God wants to take us. Despite our anxieties and worries, we must let go of what we've held on to for so long in order to grasp onto what is better and to become the people God wants us to be. So with that said, may we go forward boldly and with faith, keeping our eyes open and on God, willing to leave our homes in pursuit of the great futures awaiting each and every one of us. Thank you.
Honor of introducing our commencement speaker for today's ceremony, Ms. Faith Murphy. Mrs. Murphy is a DC alum from the class of 1994. Back then, she was known as Faith Goodson. She began at Dallas Christian in kindergarten, left for middle school, and returned for high school her sophomore year. She was an active high school student and made her impact around campus. She served as class president during her junior year and as editor of the Daily Campus her senior year. She also performed in various school plays and competition, and as a member of DC's inaugural soccer team, she played for 2 years of her high school career. She was also nominated for the homecoming court all 3 years that she attended high school at Dallas Christian. Mrs. Murphy graduated from SMU with a Bachelor's of Arts in Marketing and Advertising, with a minor in Art History and Religion. Following her time at SMU, she worked in film production, working with sports celebrities like Tom Landry, Pudge Rodriguez, and George Foreman. And she has also worked in marketing and advertising for Verizon and as a small business independent marketing consultant. Mrs. Murphy now works as a voiceover actress for film, television, and commercials. She has worked with actors such as Kevin Sorbo, Seth Green, Ashley Judd, along with artists Jerry Marcellino and Amy Grant. She is currently preparing for a mini-series about the apocalypse. Mrs. Murphy has written 7 Bible studies for her local Bible study groups. She currently teaches two Bible studies to roughly 85 to 100 people per week. She also speaks at women's conferences and retreats and organizes large-scale events for her local church in Nashville. 2 years ago, she worked with our own Martha Leeson to build a water well in Ghana. Mrs. Murphy met a wonderful Tennessee gentleman who whisked her away to Nashville, where she now lives with her 3 teenage boys and 2 dogs. While her home away from home may be in Tennessee, her blood is still charger blue. Please help me welcome this year's commencement speaker, Mrs. Faith Murphy.
Thank you. It's so nice to be with you. It's so nice to be home, both in Dallas and among my fellow Chargers. Casey, you made me sound really, really good, except for sharing what year I graduated. I appreciate that. Doesn't seem like it was really all that long ago. But I want to congratulate you, all of you. You're here. You made it. You're in your chair. You made it on time. And they are most probably going to let you graduate, right? Whew. We really weren't sure if this day would come. Am I right? Do you feel this way? Yes. They're half asleep. Can you see this? Like, they're just, You didn't think this day would come. It's like a kid at Christmas. It's like it was never going to get here, but yet here we are. I assure you that your parents also felt like this day would never come, but it is here. So we're all so grateful that you're here. We're so proud of all of you, and me as a Charger through and through. I am so proud of each of you, even though I've just met you. Many, 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 many Sunday mornings and nights, I sat in this church. This was my home church. I sat and I would watch Gary Beauchamp preach amazing sermons right here from this spot. And I have to tell you, this is a little bit of a bucket list moment because I sat where you sit, wanting his job, oddly enough. So it's kind of a great moment for me to be here. I'm not going to preach to you, don't worry. But it's really wonderful to be back. I remember graduation. In fact, I feel like I could scoot in next to you and sit there. That seems like that would be kind of normal in my book. But the good news is, if I bomb today, none of you will remember what I say a year from now. Your moms might, but you're not going to remember. So I have really nothing to lose. I sat where you sit. I feel like there's no possible way that I could be mature enough or old enough or wise enough for sure to give you any words of wisdom. When I told a friend of mine at home, and she's a dear friend, and you'll see why. When I told her I was asked to speak at my high school graduation, she looked at me, paused for really way too long, and said, "Aw, well, you've got a few months to accomplish something." I'm like, "Yeah, no, that's about how I feel. It's about how I feel. But I can't really go on. There's something on my mind, and I can't. It's just got to be said. Look, when I was sitting where you are sitting now, I didn't write thank you notes. And I love Jimmy Fallon, and he's convicted me that maybe we should do some thank you notes. Will you help me? Now, these are special thank you notes. These are thank you notes that are 20 years too late. But I'm thinking that if you help me go through these and we write them together, that maybe you'll understand a little bit the generation gap that's happening. I know you look at me and you think, "Oh, she could be graduating with us today." But no, I'm really a lot older than you. So here we go. Will you help me with some 20 years post-graduation thank you notes? You ready? Okay. Thank you, computer class in the 90s, that it took a whole semester to code a stick figure. It was worth it just to see him wave. You don't get that one, but ask your parents. They'll all understand. All right. Thank you, Dodgeball, for always leaving a mark. That one's been on my heart for a long time. All right, thank you, planet Pluto, for teaching me never to get attached to what they teach you in school. Thank you, unsafe playground equipment on the elementary playground. It's not there anymore, I checked. Falling off you taught me to be more careful all 5 times. This is cathartic. Thank you for letting me do this. Okay. Thank you, upperclassmen, who on a regular basis stuffed me in a trash can and put me on top of the lockers. What they now call bullying, I called friendship. Thank you, Mrs. Leeson, for exposing me to people groups other than my own, and also for exposing me to malaria, Ebola, Zika, West Niles, how do you spell West Niles? Dysentery, not to mention my increasing fear of needles. It was all worth it. Okay, we're almost done. Ooh, this is a good one. Thank you. Thank you, first guy who dumped me. It was great that our school was so big, I never had to see you again. Until the next class. Ooh, thank you, Mrs. Travis. Did anybody have Miss Travis? No. I'm way old. Sorry, Miss Travis, that makes you older. thank you, Mrs. Travis, my fourth grade teacher at DC, for teaching me to color outside the lines. If nothing else, it made my pictures bigger. Love you, Miss Travis. Thank you, Scantron, answer C. You were always there for me. Thank you, Dewey Decimal System. I now know how to look books up, in a way no one uses anymore. Thank you, grueling final exams. Without you, honor Spanish final exam on Don Quixote with Miss Alexander, I would not have reoccurring nightmares about showing up for a Spanish exam unprepared and in my pajamas. And lastly, thank you, Little League, for never giving me a trophy. Now, anytime I play a sport or see a cupcake, I do not have the unexplainable desire to also want a trophy. Thanks for making me a loser when I was one. Okay, I feel better. Thank you. Thank you. I feel so much, it's off my chest now. I can move on. When I was preparing to speak to you today, I started with the very prominent question that I often start conversations with God, because he has a real great sense of humor, especially where my plans are concerned. I asked him, why in the world, why would you have me there? He didn't really hesitate in giving me a message to give to you. It's really the only one that I can give you. I have to tell you, and if you were thinking that you might be getting this coming in here today, Casey said some really nice things about me, but the truth of the matter is I can't tell you a whole lot of stories about how to gain fame and fortune. I can't share with you tips about achieving your dreams before college graduation, but I've learned something that might be helpful to you. I've learned thus far, it's taken me 20 years to start putting it into practice. My hope is that I can save you a little Israelite wandering in the desert kind of time. It's how to measure success. I've learned, sometimes painfully, that the measure of success is not in feats or accomplishments. It's not in accolades, it's not in awards, it's not about who your co-star is. For me, it's not about your bank account. Believe me when I tell you that if you go out into the world thinking that the right school or the right job is going to make you successful, you will at best feel dissatisfaction at the top, because I've been there. And at worst, you'll feel disappointment in your failures. I've been there too. Because here's your optimistic message for the day. Failure's inevitable. You're welcome. C.S. Lewis once said, failures, repeated failures, are finger posts on the road to achievement. One fails forward toward success. There are things in my life, and there's things in your life, that won't always go well. Okay, at some point, you're not going to do your best on an exam. There will be relationships that you might damage, risk that you'll take that will fall flat. There will be joys, there will be jobs that you won't get. It happens. Girls will reject you. Have you found this to be true? Girls will reject you. Guys will break your heart. It happens. It's part of the messiness of life. But if you measure your success by these rises and falls, your life will feel volatile and often confusing. You'll question God, not quite understanding why this happened and this didn't happen. Or this was a good thing, why didn't it happen? Or why didn't God allow it? Or this is a bad thing, why is it happening to me? We adults still struggle with that. Failure is something that's going to happen, so let it shape you, not break you. When we were kids, you guys all probably did too, but when we were kids, we sang that sweet song, "This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it." I won't sing it for you today. Trust me, nobody wants that. It comes from a part of Psalm called the Hallel. The Hallel is a passage of scripture from like Psalm 113 and 118, and they would recite it. They would read it at any holiday, specifically Passover. So the person that was in charge of the Passover Seder, the one who would wash your feet and do all of the leading that day, was the one that would read that passage, and in that passage is, "This is the day that the Lord has made. I'll rejoice and be glad in it." Highly probable that Christ was the one, having washed feet, that he would have been the one reading that passage. And if that's true, in that last night with his chosen 12 in that upper room, he would have been the one to read that verse the night before his arrest, before his trial, his beating, and his death. The day that Christ was beaten was also a day that the Lord had made. You have all probably heard the verse so many times you could quote it in James, "Consider it pure joy," right? When you go through trials of all kinds. The only way that you can experience joy in failure is if your success is measured outside the bounds of our society's measuring stick. Contentment and joy, and for that matter, the meaning of life as a Christian, can be found simply in the act of being faithful to what God has given you just today. It's just one day at a time. Your success meter doesn't need to be any more complicated than looking around you and seeing what God has placed in your path today and acting in obedience to what needs to be done. I have had jobs that I hated passionately. I've had awkward dates with people. I've learned how to measure success in God's way. But I've questioned every place that God has put me. I've wondered if it was worth it, if the work was worth it, if I would finish strong. I would question myself and even my own integrity. I've pleaded with God to show me the big picture. God, if you just show me, I'd do everything you asked me to do. And could it end with my son, like having an ESPN moment, pounding his chest and saying, "I love you, Mom." I've asked for that. God had other plans. It's not what award show. It's not who will my co-star be. Time and time again, God has gently and sometimes quite forcefully brought me to this conclusion that success is not measured in accomplishments or accolades. Success is defined by the amount in which I'm willing to act in obedience for what he's given me to do. Sometimes that looks like scripts and movie screens and hair and makeup, and it's so much fun being able to use my gifts to show people what an actor who has a faith in Christ looks like. And other days, my obedience is like not overchecking social media to see how many likes I have. And sometimes it looks like packing my sons the most killer lunch just because I want them to have joy in the middle of their day. Sometimes that's what success looks like. For you, sometimes it's going to be like finishing that paper strong, making sure that you put in a little bit extra effort, being friends with the person on campus that you know is friendless. That's what success looks like. When you measure success on the obedience that you have today, you will feel confident, satisfied, content, purposeful, even happy, because it's easier to attain and keep. It's not, "I got the part, I didn't get the part, my child got a bad grade, so I must be a bad mom." It's truly in, am I faithful for what he gave me today? And that's what the verse means, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." We kind of don't get into the verses that come right before that in Philippians. Philippians 4:11 and following says, "For I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in all and every situation, whether fed or hungry, living in plenty or in want. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. You can't get that kind of contentment from the world. If you want to be constant, lean on a constant. Psalm 119, so we talked about the Hallel, that passage right after that, the 119. If you ever like are in a bad spot and you really need a place to flip in your Bibles, Psalm 119, it's like so long, but there's so many things in there. It talks about your mouth and your mind and your heart and your soul and your feet and your hands, and then a whole bunch of promises in between about what God promises you. But verse 71 says, it was good for me to be afflicted so that I could learn your decrees. Having the mindset that anything you endure or enjoy is intended to bring you closer to God, it can help you tremendously as you look for God's plan in your life. Acknowledge pains and failures for what they are. They're scenic landmarks on your untold story. I've auditioned for the television show Nashville, 9 times. 9 times. 10 is a charm. We're waiting for 10. I've forgotten my lines. I've procrastinated. I have put my foot in my mouth. I've called people by the wrong name. I tried out for cheerleader 4 times. Four times, and then I kept doing it. Why did I keep doing it? I learned the wrong cheer 1 time. That was fun. Back then, you had to do it in front of the entire student body. I sprained my ankle 1 time. 1 time, it was just a hard no. And then 1 time, my waistband snapped in the middle of tryouts. You're feeling my failure, right? Right. This is why I'm here today, to tell you failure happens, and look, I'm here. It's good. You're going to be all right. I made mistakes, and I messed up. I fell down. I've threatened to quit. I've questioned God. I made a mess. And these failures in retrospect brought me close to God. My 11-year-old often says, I didn't lose today, I learned. And he's right. Fail or fly, win or lose, success is all in how you were obedient to what he asked you to do today. I'm thoroughly convinced that the reason I got back up every time is not because I'm super strong or I'm resilient. It's not even because I'm a good Texas girl. It's that I got back every time because my roots were strong. And DC played a huge part in that. So please let me encourage you to not throw away your whole high school experience if you had a few bad things happen just because things didn't go the way you planned them. Keep what's good and let it be okay that this is part of the place that molded you. As you rightfully move on, move up, move out, become things, learn, grow, remember where your roots came from. Scripture tells us that a good tree makes good fruit. That's Matthew 12:33. Romans 11:18. I love this verse. It's just been on my heart. It's sitting on my dashboard right now. I just can't get away from it. It was for you and it was for me too. But a message that it reminds us that the root supports you. You don't support the root. So where you came from is your origin of strength. The roots that nurtured you at DC are made of the best stuff. Am I right? Absolutely. Hebrews 10, Paul talks about remembering the times when you were younger and you learned the truth and to not throw it away. Don't throw away your confidence. Your senior word was faith, is that right? Do you have a little thing I gave you? If you have it, I want you to hold it up. Will you hold it up? So I gave each of the seniors a little vial, and in it is a mustard seed. Just a mustard seed. How small, right? Hold it up. Let your mom see. See, Mom? It's where they started. This is to remind you. That's to remind you where you came from. See, because when the seed goes on rocky soil, what happens? It doesn't take root and the wind blows it everywhere. See, that's not you. That's not what you were given. Your seed takes root and grows mighty and strong. One of the smallest seeds, by the way, did you know that? The mustard seed. One of the smallest seeds, it produces one of the biggest bushes or trees, depending on the variety. It grows fast. It spreads wide. It gives shade. It produces fruit. It produces other products as well. In other words, it gives to the world around it. And that's you. It all starts for you right here. This is it. You're walking onto the adult world stage, and you're joining us that have been fighting the good fight. You're part of us now. To be the city on the hill, to be unstoppable, not necessarily in the big achievements, but to be unstoppable and showing what immeasurable love looks like to a world who desperately needs a savior. I want you to remember always, keep the good, excuse the bad, move forward, and with all you know, never forget where you came from. Thank you.
I knew when I called Faith and invited her to come speak at graduation that she was going to be good. But good grief, Faith. That was great. That was awesome. Thank you for giving basically two days away from your family to come down from Nashville. It was during finals, not a big deal, she says. Okay, with the graduates, candidates for graduation, please take your place. All right, graduating with high honors, Anna Rebecca Wilson. Graduating with high honors, Corey Paige McDougall. Kennedy Kate Barnett. Graduating with high honors, Anna Michelle Borgen. Jackson Arthur Bovenkamp. Benjamin Tucker Brown. Graduating with high honors, Benjamin Alejandro Bueno. Graduating with honors, Cade Logan Bull. Graduating with high honors, Sydney Lee Childs. Hayden Bethay Clark. Graduating with high honors, William D. Clevenger. Taya Codwell. Graduating with honors, James Preston Collins. Caroline Brianna Cummings. Graduating with high honors, Reagan Lane Davis. Graduating with honors, Joshua Robert De La Garza. Grant Colton Degner. Summer Marie Eason. Connor William Ellis. Graduating with honors, Casey Lynn Elrich. Graduating with honors, Brian Enrique Estrada. Jonathan William Forrester. William John Gafford. Emily Lauren Garrett. Jacob Johannan George. Graduating with high honors, Jacob Matthew Jennings. Nicholas Christian Graves. Graduating with honors, Valeria Joy Gruthus. Luke Alexander Henley. Graduating with honors, Tyler Reese Holder. Jonah Carter Hunt. Graduating with honors, Carly Ray Jones. Andrew Marshall Knapp. Graduating with high honors, Jake Timothy Langford. Graduating with honors, Michaela Renee Leach. Cameron Andrew McKay II. Christopher Deonze Marquise McCune. summer graduate, Dylan Thomas McGrady. Bethany Paige McNamee. Peyton Elizabeth Nix. Brackett Cole Owen. Cameron Dean Patterson. Christopher Daniel Pepper. Lauren Taylor Peterman. Trey Phillips III. Graduating with honors, Caitlin Suzanne Platts. John Brennan Potts. Graduating with honors, Lauren Presley Ramos. Graduating with honors, Kaylee Lynn Raspberry. Jacob Wesley Rippey. Tyler Ryan Robertson. Jacob Zachary Segoviano. Graduating with honors, Erica Savannah Sotelo. Graduating with high honors, Addison Brooke Southers. Graduating with high honors, William Lee Stegman IV. Morella Danielle Tornatore. Chad Allen Tucker. Taylor Ann Walker. Summer graduate, Kyle Wong. Travis James Wardlaw. Graduating with honors, Stone Lee Willingham. Mary Charlotte Wolfgang. Chris Wu. Daniel Sue. Ladies and gentlemen, the 2017 graduates of Dallas Christian. Seniors and their family members are invited to a reception hosted by our junior class in the fellowship hall to my left, immediately following the alma mater. Graduates, at this time, would you please join me on stage as senior parent Cameron McKay leads us in the benediction to be followed by the alma mater.
Let us pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, I'm humbled by your love for us. I'm humbled by the truth of your word. And I thank you for these graduates, for all they've accomplished here at DC and all they will accomplish in the future. I thank you for the partnership that you've given us with DC as parents. Partnership founded in your word to train up a child in the way he should go. And we fully rely on that promise, Lord, that when he becomes older, he will not depart from it. Lord, we know that that time is now. And very soon this graduating class of young adults will scatter across the state and beyond. We pray that you will watch over them as they continue their education and their lives beyond the walls of DC, beyond the walls of our homes. We pray that they will not depart from what they have been taught. When they face professors who don't believe in you and peer pressures that quite frankly frighten us as parents, because we know that Satan will use whatever weapon he can to drive a wedge between their hearts and you. But the scripture says that no weapon formed against you shall prosper. So Lord, I pray that these graduates remember to rely on you when they face adversity. Remember what they have been taught here at DC, taught at home by parents who love you, taught in church by God-loving men and women who are taught that you are truly all they need. And your grace is sufficient and your power is made perfect in our weakness. Lord, we ask that throughout their lives that you would show this graduating class your power. Show them your grace. Demonstrate for them your love. You are truly all they need. In your precious Son's name I pray. Amen.
Hail to thee, our Christian high school. Thanks and praises day we give. We extol thee, laud and glory. By thy standards may we live. Ever firm is thy foundation, ever straight thy pathways be, keeping us from worldly evil. Alma mater, hail to thee!